really. But Trump is wrong. We're wrong. And we need to ask for forgiveness.
Okay. Let's take a look at what some of the reaction is from members of Congress to the airstrike last week. Republican Senator Bob Corker from Tennessee said the following. I think as time goes on, every day that has passed, he and more has understood the gravity of U.S. leadership. The beginning thinking of the administration around Russia was somewhat upsetting, but you've seen that evolve. And from Democratic Senator Chris Murphy from Connecticut, he said, President Trump seems not to have thought through any of this or have any kind of broader strategy, but rather to have launched a military strike based on a sudden emotional decision. Richard is calling in from Rockport, Texas, on our Democratic line. What are your thoughts today, Richard?
Well, I have no confidence in President Trump's foreign policy. I would like to criticize the Republican callers. President Obama and his crossing the red line, he did what he was supposed to do. He asked Congress for permission to take action, and Congress sat on their hands. They did absolutely nothing, and I place that blame on the Senate leadership in McConnell and on the House leadership on Ryan. They need to do something to either support, follow, or get out of the way of what Trump wants to do. But however, Trump needs to go to Congress before he takes any action. And our leadership is in disarray right now. I agree with a lot of things that Eddie said, the caller from California. And my confidence.
Well, Richard, let me ask you this. Hillary Clinton said that she would be willing to take a stronger stance in Syria as well. It's something that John Kerry wanted to do in 2013, too. The Democrats, there are a lot of Democrats who support the same sort of approach. Would you still be critical of them if they did the same action?
If they went through Congress, one party is just as bad as the other if they don't go to Congress. Congress has the authority to declare war. According to the Constitution, and I think that's what we're getting into if we do such things as bomb a country without Congress's permission.
Okay. Roger's calling in from Williamstown, Kentucky on our independent line. What do you think, Roger?
Thanks for letting me make a comment. I think that for a lot of the people in America, we'll be watching the way. I know there was some bombings in Palm Sunday in Egypt with the Christians, and I know we have a lot of Christians in Syria that apparently Assad has done a good job protecting from ISIS. So I think, the American people are really tuning in to how those people are going to be protected, and I think the people will be watching how the Trump administration handles that situation. I know he campaigned a lot on trying to protect those people. Of course, I'm for the safety of all of them, whether it's the Muslim people or whatever. But that particular faith right now seems very vulnerable in the Middle East. And I don't see that our leader right now, Mr. Trump, is speaking out about that.
Okay.
And I hope that.
Okay. And coming up next, we'll be joined by Joseph Cirincione on North Korea. He'll be here to talk about North Korea's nuclear program and the recent chemical attack in Syria. And later on, author and Ronald Reagan biographer Craig Shirley will be here to discuss his latest book, which examines President Reagan's political ascendancy after losing the Republican nomination for president in 1976. Stay tuned. We'll be right back.
Washington Journal will begin in a little while.
And so here was a yellow pad where Haldeman writes down, in the midst of the October 1968, we're going to monkey wrench Lyndon Johnson's peace initiative. Now, this is something that had always been rumored, and bits of pieces had come out over the years, but Nixon denied it at the time to Lyndon Johnson, and he denied it to David Frost, and he denied it to his biographers, always said that he had never played any role in doing this.
John Farrell, longtime journalist and author of the book Richard Nixon, The Life, on Mr. Nixon's political career, from his early days in Congress to his tenure and downfall as president.
The way that the Watergate burglars were, their team was assembled, was clumsy. They were cynical, burnt out former intelligence or FBI agents who were supervised by young men on Nixon's staff who just wanted to be, as one of the famous quotes go, the cat that brought the dead mouse to the president's door.
Tonight at 8 Eastern on C-SPAN's Q&A.
Tonight on Afterwards, Blue on Blue, an insider's story of good cops catching bad cops. Author Charles Campisi, former chief of the NYPD Internal Affairs Bureau, talks about his book with Corey Pegues, former NYPD officer and author of Once a Cop.
I spent 41 years in the NYPD. I saw acts of courage, bravery, integrity. But there's always that small number of cop who keeps you up at night. When I was a precinct commander, everyone knew the person, or maybe two, that you didn't trust. Mm-hmm. And the other officers didn't trust him or her either. So what I did when I went to Internal Affairs is I brought the commanding officers on board. And we would meet with them on a regular basis. And I would ask them questions like, who in your command are you a little concerned about? Who in your command keeps you up at night?
Watch Afterwards, tonight at 9 p.m. Eastern, on C-SPAN 2's Book TV.
Washington Journal continues.
And joining us now is Joseph Cirincione. He is the president of Plowshares Fund.
Yes.
And he's here to discuss rising tensions in North Korea, as well as the recent chemical attack in Syria. Joe, thank you so much for joining us.
My pleasure, Kimberly. Thanks for having me.
So let's start about talking about the Plowshares Fund. What is it? Tell us a little bit about it.
It's an organization started 35 years ago by people in San Francisco who thought that Ronald Reagan and late Ed Brezhnev were going to get us into a global thermonuclear war. The name is obviously taken from the Bible, the book of Isaiah, appropriate here on Palm Sunday. They shall beat their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks and make war no more. And so we're dedicated to reducing nuclear threats. We are now going to be fighting against the increase in the military budget. We don't think we need more weapons taken away from our other pressing security and domestic needs, and we're starting to invest more in the mass movement, this historic, unprecedented civic involvement that has occurred just over the last 100 days or so in our nation. We're getting more involved in that. So we raise money from generous people and give it to the best people with the smartest ideas. So if you either have money or need money, please call me after the show.
And the website there is plowshares.org for more information.
And
there.
Spelled the English way, P-L-O-U-G-H.
Thank you. Plowshares. Thank you for that. So there were two major international incidents that we're talking about now. We had the situation in North Korea as well as in Syria. First, let's talk about North Korea, more missile tests being done there. What's your reaction to that?
North Korea is ramping up its program. I've been tracking this program for almost 35 years. I've been here in Washington doing nuclear policy all that time. We've never seen a period like this. They've always been playing with it. They've always been making some advances, but they've done more tests in the last couple of years than they've done probably in the history of the program. If they are not stopped, they will get what they don't have now, a long-range ballistic missile, an ICBM, that could hit at least the west coast of the United States, and not just an atomic bomb, a Hiroshima-type bomb to put on it, but probably an H-bomb, a thermonuclear bomb, 10, 20, 30 times more powerful than those weapons. That's where they're going. I expect we might see another nuclear test relatively soon. We've seen their test sites. One of our grantees, a group called 38 North, does satellite surveillance of the test site, interprets it. There's a lot of activity going on. April 15th is the birthday, the anniversary of the founder of North Korea, Kim Il-sung. So that's a time when they normally do something like this. So you could see a new test this month. That's one of the reasons U.S. Navy ships are steaming towards the Korean Peninsula, at least to be prepared.
Yes, and that latest news, it says a U.S. Navy strike group led by the USS Carl Vinson aircraft carrier was making its way towards the Korean Peninsula Sunday to maintain readiness as Kim Jong-un's regime in North Korea prepared to mark key anniversaries this coming week. Mm-hmm. What do you expect from this, and what other U.S. reaction do you think there should be?
So you never know for sure, but I would say this is a reassurance move. This is what you want our allies, Japan and South Korea, but also the region as a whole, to know that we got their back. We have a military force there that is formidable. I mean, a Navy aircraft carrier strike force has a lot of destructive power in its ships, in its planes. In case anything provocative should happen, we'd be able to take care of them. So it's mainly for reassurance. It also is an implied threat, particularly after the strike on Syria. You know, there's some that are thinking that Donald Trump wants to be unpredictable, wants to have the threat that he would take military action against North Korea, even after something that's relatively benign, that is not directly threatening, like another missile test, like a nuclear weapon test.
Okay, and we are talking with Joseph Cirincione, president of Plowshares Fund. It's Plowshares or the Plowshares?
Plowshares.
It's Plowshares, yes. Fund. Okay, I got it right the first time. Republicans can call 202-748-8001, Democrats 202-748-8000, and Independents 202-748-8002. Now let's turn to Syria for a moment after the airstrikes there. What's your reaction both to those, both to the chemical attack there and the U.S. response?
Well, the chemical attack is horrendous, and it deserves the strongest possible international reaction. I'm somewhat disappointed that it's only the United States, frankly, that has taken action and not our other NATO allies. And it's exactly this kind of situation where military strike does have some justification to try to stop this horrific attack. Now, fortunately, we got almost all the chemical weapons out of Syria already. As bad as this was, 140 people killed, Bashar had enough chemical weapons, about 1,300 tons of nerve gas and mustard gas, enough to kill every man, woman, and child in the Middle East. Fortunately, the deal that Obama and Secretary Kerry struck got all of that out. It doesn't look like we got it all, or they may have made some new ones, and it's terrible that that exists, but it could have been so much worse. So we're lucky that we had that deal. What does the strike do? Unfortunately, not too much. It isn't really very militarily effective. Over the last 2 or 3 years, since 2014, the U.S. forces and our coalition forces have conducted almost 20,000 airstrikes against in Iraq and Syria. About half in Syria. It's cost us almost $12 billion. So compared to that amount of ordnance, that amount of military operation, the President Trump's strike is a pinprick. It hardly matters. And as you can see, the Syrian planes are flying again from that airstrip. They're bombing again the town that was hit with the chemical strike. So a lot depends on what happens next. Where's the strategy? What flows from this, or was it just a one-off that got some favorable press for a couple of days?
And one of U.S. allies, Britain, the coverage, their headlines today is that Russia is accused of complicity in a Syria war crime. That's the front page of the Sunday Times in the U.K. And the BBC reports that Russia is to blame for every Syrian death in last week's chemical weapons attack in Syria, Defense Secretary Sir Michael Fallon has claimed. What's your thought to that?
I think that's true. It's like the person who buys the gun and gives it to the killer. The killer then goes, shoot somebody, and you say, I didn't do it. Well, they were there at the air base. We don't know exactly, but somewhere between a dozen to 100 Russian personnel, they were assisting in this. The munitions that they used, the planes that they used, Russian supplied. Russia's been giving them logistical support. And that's just in the immediate act. Over the last several years, Russia's moved in big into Syria. Assad was teetering. He was on the verge of collapse. The Russians came in and propped him up and have done almost all the massive, I've been responsible for most of the massive killing over the last couple of years. It was horrendous before that. It's gotten a lot worse since the Russians entered in this way, and the Iranians as well, more with ground troops, but the Iranians bear blame here as well.
Okay, we are talking to Joseph Cirincione of Plowshares Fund about the situation in Syria with the chemical weapons attack there, as well as the nuclear activity in North Korea. Ronald's calling from Fayetteville, North Carolina, on our Democratic line. Good morning, Ronald.
Yes, ma'am. Good morning, ma'am. How you doing? My question to my guest is, okay, everybody is over later as far as those cruise missiles that were sent into Syria. Do they know exactly how much those things cost? And the airport is still running, you know. We need to have a good foreign policy if we're going to be doing something like that. I would think, you know, that we need to, next time we send a missile strike, we need to take out the airport instead of, the airport is open right now. So that's my biggest thing. If they shoot it off another chemical, then what?
Yes, exactly. That's exactly right. Well, as far as this particular strike, 59 Tomahawks from Navy cruisers and destroyers, two boats, two ships, cost about $50 million to do this strike. That's for the ordnance. Doesn't really count the operation. Some people say perhaps as much as $80 million total. The Pentagon has contingencies for everything. Believe me, I've worked with the military for many, many years. Used to be on the House Armed Services Committee staff over in the Congress. And I have a tremendous appreciation for their skill, for their ability to plan with precision. So they presented the president with a series of options. Three major options were chosen, according to reports, and he picked the lightest one, the one with the least possibility of killing Russians or escalating the conflict. And he chose not to crater the runway. We have weapons that could have cratered that runway, be a more powerful strike. It might have required some air delivery, but we even have Tomahawks that are capable of cratering the runway. We chose not to do it. I just don't know why. I think it's a very bad image to see these Syrian planes taking off again. And there doesn't appear to be a plan for what next. And this is the big criticism. President Trump doesn't have a foreign policy. He has a series of impulses. He doesn't have a strategic vision. He has a collection of ideas, of actions that he wants to take for various reasons. We'll have to see. Then what happens over the next week or so could be the most important week yet in this still young presidency.
And in a statement on Syria, Israeli Prime Minister Benjamin Netanyahu said he hopes the U.S. strike on Syria will resonate not only in Damascus. He said Israel fully supports President Trump's decision and hopes that this message of resolve in the face of the Assad regime's horrific actions will resonate not only in Damascus, but in Tehran and Pyongyang and elsewhere. What's your reaction to that?
This school of thought out there that only military strikes show resolve. Patient diplomacy isn't resolve. Wisdom isn't resolve. Getting agreement, that's not resolve. No, you have to drop bombs on people. And it's fed by the fascination of our media, frankly, who love to watch things blow up. So this strike was very popular with politicians, very popular with journalists, no offense, very popular with the public. I mean, people watch this thing. You put this on, this is gripping TV. This is must-see TV. People's ratings go up when we go to war. So there's a Washington establishment impulse to support this kind of thing. And then you have people like Netanyahu who want to then take it to something else. They don't really care that much about Syria. What they care about is Iran. Okay, now go do something tough with Iran. So you already see people writing op-eds, let's go to war with Iran. Let's go show Iran our resolve. That is idiotic. That is idiotic. You cannot apply this strike against a relatively weak and relatively defenseless Syria to North Korea and Iran. Why? North Korea and Iran shoot back. You hit them, they're going to hit back. There is no one-off strike with those guys. You hit them, you're starting a war, and you better be ready for it.
But does the strike in Syria serve as any detrimental, preventative to Iran or North Korea? Does that make them think twice?
Yes. I would say it does, Kimberly. I think there's a little bit of hesitation, not because of resolve, but because of unpredictability. You know, it's kind of that Nixon madman theory. They're thinking, whoa, this guy actually could do this. For example, during the Iraq War in 2003, the 2003 invasion, I was completely against that. I was at the Carnegie Endowment. I was writing about it and saying, no, he doesn't have WMD. We have inspectors on the ground. You don't need to go to war to get the WMD. And I was convinced up until the last moment that President Bush wouldn't do this because it was so stupid. But just because something is stupid doesn't mean presidents won't do it. So you do have to be worried that there'll be some kind of calculation or miscalculation in Korea that could lead to the president ordering a strike of some kind. Conventional, maybe, some of his advisors are urging, even nuclear. So yes, the risk calculations go up tremendously, and that does start to factor into North Korean and Iranian calculations.
Okay, Ali is calling from Warren, Minnesota on our independent line. Good morning, Ali.
Good morning. I'd like to inform the American people that first of all, Bashar Assad, he did not attack with chemical weapons or nothing. Bashar Assad attacked the ISIS's weapon depot. Uh-huh. ISIS produced the chemical weapons. And for those chemical weapons, ISIS gets all those ingredients from Turkish chemical factories. All the ISIS fighters, those subhumans, I like to call them, when they get injured on the battlefield, they go to Turkey hospitals. They get the top health care by Turkish government, especially Recep Tayyip Erdogan, and they get financed from Saudi Arabia, Qatar, and Turkey. Now, this is the proxy war. First, we have to handle what is going on in there. You know what is going on? The big gas and oil pipeline going to come from Qatar to the Mediterranean. So some country, I don't know who, maybe U.S. or maybe some other people, they want to destabilize Middle East, including northern Iraq. Now they're building another country called Kurdistan, which is Iran against to that, Turkey against to that, Syria against to that. Mm-hmm. But still, we are destabilizing the Middle East.
Okay, let's give Joe a chance to respond to that.
Let me agree with the last part of your statement. We are definitely destabilizing the Middle East. I mean, ever since the Iraq invasion of 2003, the Middle East has been more or less rapidly falling apart. We went in and just started knocking things over, knocking down long-standing governments. It was Afghanistan and Iraq, and it just rippled out. There were democratic currents who thought that now was the time the Arab Spring rises up, but the forces of dictatorship come and clamp down. The American people are tired of 14, 15 years of war there. They don't want us to go back. But the region is really in chaos because of what we did in 2003. A lot of the columns you see, even today, Robert Kagan in the Washington Post, he blames it all on Obama. Obama, he came in and tried to fix this mess, couldn't do it, couldn't fix it fast enough. I think we're in for a couple of decades of tumult and chaos in the Middle East. But about this idea that the chemical weapons came from ISIS, this is what the Russians say. This is what Syria says. We don't have chemical weapons. This is by the definition of fake news. It's not a news broadcast that you disagree with. No, it's something that's made up with not a shred of evidence to support it. There is no evidence to support what you just said, I'm afraid. It's Syria that has the chemical weapons, that knows how to make sarin. It's quite possible that we got all the weapons out, but they were able to remake it in a basement in a small office undetected. There's no evidence that ISIS has this kind of capability. And if they had it, why haven't they used it? The only people we've seen using this has been the Syrian Air Force. So I'm afraid this is a Syrian effort. I think he thought he got the green light. Remember just a week ago, Rex Tillerson, our Secretary of State, and others in the White House said that we didn't care if Assad stayed or not. That wasn't our business. It was up to the Syrian people. I think Assad thought he had the green light. He's been losing a little militarily in the last few weeks, particularly in that rebel-controlled area. So he wanted to panic those people, show them he could do whatever he wanted. He got cocky. He got arrogant. And this time it came back to bite him.
Your organization partnered with two members of Congress, Democrat Congressman Ted Lieu and Democratic Senator Edward Markey. Mm-hmm. Congressman Lieu of California and Senator Markey of Massachusetts, to file the Redistricting First Use of Nuclear Weapons Act of 2017. Tell us what that is.
Sure, restricting the first use. Most people by now have come to understand that the only person in the United States who can authorize the use of a nuclear weapon is the president. And once the president makes that decision, he can give the order, and within 4 minutes the missiles will be flying and they cannot be recalled. There's no Tom Cruise who's going to come in and hack the guidance system and redirect it. That doesn't happen. They go, they're designed to go. The decision process is designed to be decisive and rapid. So he doesn't have to consult with Congress, doesn't have to consult with his with his cabinet. There's nobody who can overrule him. So you just saw the President of the United States make a very impulsive decision, make a 180-degree turn on one of his core foreign policy issues, do not bomb Syria, and 48 hours later, 60 hours later, he's bombing Syria. This president could also decide to use a nuclear weapon in less time. Should he have that authority? Should any president have that authority? This is what Ted Lieu, a veteran, an Air Force veteran, says. This is what Ed Markey, a longtime legislator on Capitol Hill, says. Let's restore the congressional role. If the president wants to use a nuclear weapon first, we're not under attack. It's his choice to go first. He should bring that decision to Congress. Congress and Congress alone has the constitutional authority to declare war, and it should matter in the most serious war of all nuclear. If you agree with this, please go to our website, plowshares.org, and sign our petition. We're trying to get 500,000 signatures to present the congressmen, and are going to have a conference when they come back from recess, a press conference, to publicize the bill.
All right, Bob's calling from Old Fort, Tennessee, on our Republican line. Good morning, Bob.
Okay, I appreciate you taking my call. First of all, Trump's not going to tell you exactly what he's going to do. Unlike, I'll give you 8 months to go hide everything you got, and because that's a dumb strategy. Just, and the UN's another big problem, because like in football, you don't go tell the other team, hey, we're going to have 10 run plays and 2 throw plays. You know, they'll prepare for it. So, yeah. But anyways.
Yeah, and I would agree. That's an interesting part of his policy and a key part of his strategy, surprise, and to create new facts on the ground, widen the operating space. Yes.
Marjorie's calling from Jamaica, New York, on our Democratic line. Marjorie, you are on. Good morning.
Good morning. I'm so happy that you took my call. My belief is that Trump and Al-Assad are both owned by Putin. After Nunes fell through, he needed cover. And I believe that Putin is giving him this cover. I don't think it has anything to do about what a big guy he is. And he's taking on people because of what happened. I believe that it's Putin that's propping him up. Thank you so much.
Oh, that's absolutely true. Syria is very important to Russia, which is why they're so angry now at this strike. This is their only overseas military facility. It's a warm water port that they get on the Syria coastline. This is one of their few allies. When you think of Russia, it's really isolated in the world. Belarus and Syria, that's pretty much its core ally. So yes, Putin's hand is definitely behind this. If Russia would just cooperate in forging a diplomatic solution, which is the only way this war is going to end. There's no military solution to this civil war. If Putin would cooperate, we could resolve the Syria problem in a matter of months. A ceasefire, humanitarian corridors for assistance, safe zones for people. All this could be done if Russia would cooperate.
We're talking to Joseph Cirincione, president of Plowshares Fund, also a former senior vice president of national security and international policy at the Center for American Progress, and formerly director for nonproliferation at the Carnegie Endowment for International Peace. Now let's go back to North Korea for a moment. The BBC put out some maps that demonstrate the nuclear capabilities there, just how far they can reach. What do we know about North Korea's nuclear capability, and can it reach the United States?
You know, we have very good intelligence services in this country. I mean, we knew in Syria, for example, we knew the airfield where the chemical attack had taken place. We knew the plane that had delivered the bomb. So don't underestimate what we know. We know that North Korea has made enough material for somewhere around 20 nuclear weapons. It's not clear how many of those they've manufactured. It's not absolutely certain whether they've gotten them small enough to be able to put on the nose cone of a missile, but we believe that's true. We know that they do not have a long-range missile. They don't have something that can hit the United States, which is good, because we would have no way to stop it, despite our interceptors that we deployed. Our interceptors are completely ineffective against even a primitive ICBM threat. What they do have is short-range missiles, Scuds and Nodongs and others, that can hit South Korea, that can hit Japan. So right now, as opposed to 10 years ago, South Korea and Japan are under risk of nuclear-armed missiles from North Korea. And this is an extremely serious situation. Their arsenal is growing. We estimate that if this continues, certainly within the next 5 to 10 years, they might have 100 nuclear weapons and long-range missiles that could hit the United States, fundamentally altering the strategic calculus in the region.
Okay, on our Republican land, we have Alfred calling from the Bronx. You are on with Joseph Cirincione.
Yes, good morning, Suspan.
Good morning. I was born in the Bronx. Maybe you can tell by my accent.
Okay, I live in Boston Road, you know, at Pelham Parkway. I know you. I mean, I know you. You believe where he's there, you're there.
Yeah.
I believe this was, first mistake of the president Trump. I voted for him. Mm. I vote Democrat normally, but this time I voted for him. I am unhappy for one thing, because in Syria, the dictator Assad is only the dictator who has to save Christian Syrians. For years, is only safe haven for Christians in Syria. President Trump is much better to create a safe haven for Christians from all over the region rather than attack and remove him. Because if he's going to remove Assad, we know who's going to come in. The other people, they're going to come in, Muslims are going to come in, and they're going to start attacking Christians, just like they do in Egypt, in Libya, in any other countries.
This is a very good point. You know, President Obama gets a bum rap for so-called hesitation. What it was thinking out the problem. He didn't want to make what we call the fallacy of the last move, thinking that you make a move and then the game's over. No, the game's not over. The other side gets a move, gets many moves. So you do something like a bombing attack, where does that go? What happens when it proves to be ineffective? Do you ratchet up? Do you commit more forces? And where does that end? How do you solve this problem? And one of the things they concluded back then is just what you say. There are worse things in Syria than Assad. There are worse things in Syria than Assad. If you knock off Assad, you create a power vacuum. Who fills that vacuum? Well, it's not the U.S.-backed rebels. It's almost certainly ISIS and other extremist groups that then sweep in and establish a new base, and this time take over the military apparatus that Assad leaves behind. Is that what you want? How do you prevent that from happening? So you can see this is a much more complicated picture. Unless you're willing, seriously, to put in hundreds of thousands of U.S. ground troops, there is no quick and easy solution, certainly not militarily, to ending the Syrian civil war.
All right, Michael's calling on the Democratic line from Tyrone, New York. Good morning.
Yes, good morning. I have a couple of good points as far as I heard the gentleman say that the strategy about not letting the enemy know or the adversary know what you're doing, okay? That's okay and all, but you have to plan this stuff out. And the way it's going about, we have a president that's a knee-jerk decision maker, and that was mentioned in the election when he was running for office. And the other candidate, Hillary, she wasn't this knee-jerk person. That she had a plan. You needed a plan to go after foreign policy and to control things like this. Now we have to put an aircraft carrier as a security measure. I think Mr. Trump is making knee-jerk decisions, and it's very important that we focus on this nuclear threat, because if all you have to do is go online and Google the information on Hiroshima and Nagasaki, and like you said, you're talking about a 40-megaton bomb that is, like, catastrophic.
Yeah.
And, Go ahead.
Yeah, so you're seeing a lot of concern about this. I mean, even as there's relatively broad support, you know, the Washington establishment is real. There really is kind of an establishment mindset. Ben Rhodes used to call it the blob. And this mindset is generally in favor of military action. It's true. We live in a town where people like to see presidents take military action. Even though it's generally favorable to this, the concern is then what happens next. And the concern is the way the decision was made, how abruptly the president changed his mind. And there's concern about what this sets for the future. The president feels this worked, is he going to do it again? And will it involve nuclear? And, you know, this is the interesting thing that's happened over the last several decades. We have very large nuclear bombs, gigantic, 20, 30, 50 times more than Hiroshima. We also have small nuclear bombs. And there's a group of people in Washington who are pushing the use of newer, smaller nuclear weapons so that we won't be self-deterred, is the phrase, self-deterred from using them. For example, we have a bomb that could have been dropped on that airfield, not 59 cruise missiles, one cruise missile that could have taken out the airfield. There would be no craters except one that would just eliminate that airfield, but it would be relatively contained. It's a very neat kind of solution, very dramatic kind of solution, and you see people proposing that we do things like that. My fear is that that kind of proposal bubbles up, maybe through Steve Bannon, captures the attention of the president, and he does something that we will regret for decades to come.
Okay, Joseph Cirincione, president of Plowshares Fund, also author of Nuclear Nightmares, Securing the World Before It Is Too Late. Thank you for joining us this morning.
Thank you.
And coming up, we're going to have author and Ronald Reagan biographer Craig Shirley here to discuss his latest book, which examines President Reagan's political ascendancy after losing the Republican nomination for president in 1976. And later on, Migration Policy Institute's Randy Capps will be here to talk about the sharp drop in border apprehensions at the U.S.-Mexico border and the effects of Trump administration immigration policies so far. We'll be right back.
This week in prime time on C-SPAN, Monday at 8 p.m. Eastern, from the National Review Ideas Summit in Washington, D.C., conservatives discussing Hollywood, politics, and pop culture.
They have equality of choice with women and men. Those are all things that native populations don't have. We have them because we have oil. And oil, you know, with oil you can have a light at night, you can fly, you can have the technology that gives women more choices. So if you change the premises, you can actually say something that feels true and beautiful in the world of the movie, but isn't in fact.
Tuesday at 8 p.m. Eastern, former U.S. Attorney for the Southern District of New York, Preet Bharara, at Cooper Union in New York City. Wednesday at 8 p.m. Eastern, Ann Holton, former Virginia Education Secretary and wife of Democratic Senator Tim Kaine, shares her views about public education.
I think that we have to remember that local ownership of schools has a lot to do with that positive support for schools.
Thursday at 8 p.m. Eastern, a panel on the prescription drug addiction crisis in the U.S., hosted by the University of Southern California.
They've created name things, right, and then make a drug for it and tell you, do you have this? Do you ever can't sleep at night? Do you ever have anxiety? Are you ever hungry? You know? Everybody's had these symptoms. Well, we have a drug for it. And then everybody, oh my God, I better go get some testosterone.
Friday at 8 p.m. Eastern, Supreme Court Justice Sonia Sotomayor talks to students at Stanford University about her path to the nation's highest court.
Curious people go further. It is curiosity that leads you to experience new things and might lead you to find an interest that you never imagined.
This week at 8 p.m. Eastern on C-SPAN.
Washington Journal continues.
And joining us now is Craig Shirley. He's the author of Reagan Rising, The Decisive Years, 1976 to 1980. And he is here to discuss that book, which examines President Reagan's political ascendancy after losing the nomination for president in 1976. Craig, thank you for joining us today.
Thank you.
So you've written several books about President Reagan. Why did you focus on this particular era, this 1976 to 1980, in this book?
It's a missing chapter to his life, and it's very, very important because without the developmental years of 76 to 80, he doesn't become president. Is that after he lost the nomination to Gerald Ford in 1976, a lot of people said, all right, he's been around the track twice. He tried in 68, he lost, and tried in 76 and lost. Now he's 65 years old. The issues have moved beyond him. The campaign has moved beyond him. The party has moved beyond him. And he and Mrs. Reagan thought otherwise. Even at the after the 76 campaign, when President Carter defeated President Ford, Reagan convened a meeting at his house in California, he and Mrs. Reagan, with his old campaign staff, and to let them know that they were going to run again. And a lot of his staff was very, very reluctant, with the exception of the Californians around Reagan. And a lot of them actually moved on to other campaigns and candidates for 1980. That's how reluctant they were to sign on one more time with Reagan's run. But so this era is very, very important because not only is President Carter presiding over the nation, but a lot of his policies are being rejected by conservatives. And there's a conservative enlightenment that's taking hold in America over the Panama Canal treaties and the creation of the Heritage Foundation and Prop 13. There's a lot of creative conservative revolt going on across the country in this time period.
So talking a little bit more with that frame mind and what was happening to the Republican Party, then remind our viewers what happened at the Republican National Convention in 1976 and how it opened up some new wounds within the GOP, sort of like a battle between the establishment and an outsider.
It is the quintessential battle between the insiders backing Gerald Ford and the outsiders backing Ronald Reagan. The entire Republican Party establishment, from the National Committee to the state parties to all the elected officials, are all supporting Gerald Ford, his nomination, because he wasn't being renominated because he'd been appointed by Richard Nixon in 74 as his successor. So the entire establishment, and Reagan has very little support among the Republican establishment. You know, Senator Jesse Helms of North Carolina, Phil Crane, congressman from Illinois, and a few others, but he runs a really kind of outsider ragtag operation. Now, he's supported by most of the conservative movement, you know, Human Events and National Review, Bill Buckley, Richard Viguerie, Paul Weyrich, others noteworthy of the movement, but even so, they can't entirely match the firepower of the National Committee. So it is literally over 30 primaries and conventions over 76. It's a seesaw battle. Is that Ford wins the first five primaries narrowly. Reagan comes back and wins Texas, Indiana, Georgia, Alabama strongly. Then Ford comes back and wins another handful of primaries, Tennessee, Kentucky. And then Reagan comes back and wins a lot of state conventions. So they go to the convention in Kansas City in August of 1976, not knowing who the nominee of the party was going to be. It was that close. And there were that many undecided delegates. It's the first time since 52 when Republicans gathered in Chicago, not knowing who the nominee was going to be. Was it going to be Senator Robert Taft of Ohio or General Dwight Eisenhower? And so the situation is identical in that, is that they gather in the convention city. They don't know who the nominee is going to be.
Wow. Okay. We are talking to Craig Shirley, the author of Reagan Rising, The Decisive Years, 1976 to 1980. Republicans can call 202-748-8001. Democrats, 202-748-8000. And independents, 202-748-8002. So let's take a look at President Reagan at the 1976 convention and what he said there.
The challenges confronting us, the erosion of freedom that has taken place under Democrat rule in this country, the invasion of private rights the controls and restrictions on the vitality of the great free economy that we enjoy. These are our challenges that we must meet. And then again, there is that challenge of which he spoke, that we live in a world in which the great powers have poised and aimed at each other horrible missiles of destruction, nuclear weapons that can in a matter of minutes arrive in each other's country and destroy virtually the civilized world we live in. And suddenly it dawned on me, those who would read this letter 100 years from now will know whether those missiles were fired. They will know whether we met our challenge, whether they have the freedoms that we have known up until now will depend on what we do here. Will they look back with appreciation and say, thank God for those people in 1976 who headed off that loss of freedom, who kept us now 100 years later free, who kept our world from nuclear destruction? And if we failed, they probably won't get to read the letter at all, because it spoke of individual freedom and they won't be allowed to talk of that or read of it. This is our challenge. And this is why, here in this hall tonight, better than we've ever done before, we've got to quit talking to each other and about each other and go out and communicate to the world that we may be fewer in numbers than we've ever been, but we carry the message they're waiting for. We must go forth from here united, determined, that what a great general said a few years ago is true. There is no substitute for victory. Mr. President.
So that was then Governor Reagan speaking at the Republican National Convention. Give us the background to that moment and why it was so significant.
Well, Ford has just won the nomination the day before. He goes over the top. Reagan loses the nomination by 67 delegate votes out of 2,267 cast. There's a lot of animosity between these two warring camps. There's a lot of bitterness. Ford has just given his acceptance speech, was uncharacteristically good. Ford was not a good public speaker, but he practiced doing the speech. But he's presiding over a divided Republican Party, and he's running, by the way, 30 points behind Governor Carter in the polls in August of 76. He has to have a unified convention, and the only way to unify the convention is to ask Governor Reagan to say a few words. So Reagan very, very reluctantly goes to the podium, but only after 17,000 assembled in Kemper Arena are all chanting and calling for him to come down. Now, this is grace under pressure. This is what John Kennedy talked about, grace under pressure, because Reagan gives this speech extemporaneously, no notes, no teleprompter, no time to prepare. 17,000 people have their eyes on him, and it's being broadcast live on all three networks. Millions of people are watching at home. And this is part of the speech that he gives, which I'm convinced rivals 1964 speech for Goldwater as his most important political speech. And it may be actually more important than 64, because while 64 sets him on a path to run for the California governorship, this speech sets him on a path to run for president in 1980. Because afterward, he's campaigning all through the summer and fall of 76. Everywhere he goes, people are pleading with him. Cops, firefighters, chambermaids are all saying, oh, Governor, you've got to run one more time. You just got to do it one more time.
Okay. Carol is calling from Elgin, Texas on our independent line. Carol, you're on with President Reagan biographer Craig Shirley.
Good morning, and good morning, Chief Man. Thank you for taking my call. I just wanted to ask you something, since you're a historian about Ronald Reagan. I'd like to ask you something about what you think Ronald Reagan would do today, you know, given he's the man who asked Gorbachev to bring down the wall in Berlin and in Germany. What do you think he would do given the interference and influence that Putin is showing not only in our election, but especially in Brexit and in the dismantling of the European Eurozone and the common market? And I wonder what you think Reagan would do.
That's a good question. I'm trying to unpackage it. Is that Reagan was a party man. Once he switched to the Republican Party, he supported Republicans of all stripes, unless, of course, he was running in a primary against them like Gerald Ford. But he campaigned for moderate Republicans and conservative Republicans. He didn't get involved in any primaries after 1976. As far as Russia goes, of course, he was very skeptical of and opposed deeply the Soviet Union. Of course, now we're dealing with something different, not the Soviet Union, but Russia. But nonetheless, Putin is an oligarch, and he would have been very skeptical of dealing too weakly with Putin. I can't, you know, I think it's dangerous for some historians say, well, Reagan would have done this or John Kennedy would have done that. We don't know what they would have done. So all we can do is go on their history and their behavior as president of the United States. Reagan was very tough on the Soviets, and yet he was also signed the IMF deal with Gorbachev. I recall one situation where the Soviets captured a reporter, a Western reporter by the name of Nicholas Danilov, and accused him of being an American spy. And Reagan retaliated by releasing the names of 1,000 Soviet agents operating in and around the United Nations. You know, his response was, okay, you're going to arrest Danilov. I'll show you, you know, what I can do in response. So he usually dealt with these situations with strength and determination. But to say what he would do today, I think it would be reckless for me to say what Reagan would do today. I can only go on what he did in the past.
Okay, Bill is calling in from Knoxville, Tennessee, on our Democratic line. Good morning, Bill.
Good morning. I was just wanting to ask the fella, how did 1968 form his thoughts for the 4 years that you, the 76 to 80? What was it that, I believe Ronald Reagan was the last person to ever announce on the first day of the convention. How did that form his thoughts, and what was that like? And a lot of people don't talk about that a whole lot.
Yeah, you're talking about 68, right?
And I'll let you go.
You're talking about 68?
Yes, he said 68.
Yeah, okay, but then he said 76. 68 taught him he needed to prepare better to run for president. People don't realize how close he came. And you're right, he announced his candidacy in 68 for president on the day the convention opened in Miami Beach that year. Of course, Richard Nixon won the nomination. But Nixon had a very, very tenuous hold on the Republican Party nomination. Of course, they polled alphabetically in those days, you know, Alaska, Arizona, Arkansas. And Nixon did not get the nomination till Wisconsin, till the W's. Reagan actually had 300-400 delegate votes at the convention. And if he had started earlier and worked it more assiduously, he may well have won the nomination in 1968. So 68 did teach him that he later convened a meeting with some campaign aides and talked about the future. But of course, Nixon was elected in 68. It looked like he was going to serve for two terms. And then the question became, would Reagan be too old by 1976? Because he'd be 65 at that point. And would there be another candidate? Of course, John Connally was Richard Nixon's darling, and Nixon wanted to ensure that Connally got the nomination in 1976 and did everything he could to ensure that happened. The Milk Fund scandal kind of derailed Connally's candidacy, but even so, with 68, the bottom line is that 68 taught Reagan that if you want to be president, you got to prepare for it.
We are talking with Craig Shirley, a Reagan biographer whose latest book looks at the years 1976 to 1980. He's also written other books about Ronald Reagan, including Reagan's Revolution, The Untold Story of the Campaign That Started It All, and Rendezvous with Destiny, Ronald Reagan and the Campaign That Changed America. So tell us what happened after this 1976 loss. What did he do after losing this fight?
He starts campaigning for 1980. He forms a political committee, Citizens for the Republic, and he uses that as a platform from which to speak out on major issues of the day. He uses that to help conservative candidates running around the country. The Panama Canal treaties are raging as an issue in 1977. Gerald Ford had supported what was called the giveaway of the Panama Canals to the country of Panama, and then Jimmy Carter also supported. Reagan opposed it, as did many other conservatives. They've been taught since the time they were children that it was one of the seven great wonders of the world, and he would campaign and get prompt crowds to go crazy. You know, he'd thunder, "We built it, we paid for it, it's ours, and we're going to keep it." But he becomes the leader of the opposition to the Panama Canal treaties, and he's so potent that Jimmy Carter gives a speech one night on national television advocating the passage of the treaties in the Senate. In the speech, he indirectly attacks Governor Reagan and a private citizen, Ronald Reagan, in 1977. And CBS News the next day calls private citizen Ronald Reagan and says, "Would you like a half hour of network time, prime time, to respond to Governor Carter or President Carter?" And Reagan, of course, jumps at the chance. But I mean, this would never happen today. But a private citizen is given a half hour of prime time to respond to the President of the United States. So Reagan is the leader. He leads a truth squad around the country. And the Panama Canal treaties thereafter only passed the Senate by 1-2 votes, more than the two-thirds necessary for a treaty. But the potency was there, and Carter gained no political currency out of the issue, but Reagan got a lot of currency.
Okay, we are continuing our discussion with Reagan biographer Craig Shirley. Just a reminder that Republicans can call 202-748-8001, Democrats 202-748-8000, and Independents 202-748-8002. So we get to the 1980 campaign, and let's take a look at President Reagan making his announcement for president then.
"I believe this nation hungers for a spiritual revival, hungers to once again see honor placed above political expediency, to see government once again the protector of our liberties, not the distributor of gifts and privilege. Government should uphold and not undermine those institutions which are custodians of the very values upon which civilization is founded: religion, education, and above all, family. Government cannot be clergyman, teacher, and parent. It is our servant, beholden to us. We who are privileged to be Americans have had a rendezvous with destiny since the moment in 1630 when John Winthrop, standing on the deck of the tiny Arabella off the coast of Massachusetts, told the little band of pilgrims, 'We shall be as a city upon a hill. The eyes of all people are upon us, so that if we shall deal falsely with our God in this work we have undertaken, and so cause him to withdraw his present help from us, we shall be made a story and a byword throughout the world. A troubled and afflicted mankind looks to us, pleading for us to keep our rendezvous with destiny, that we will uphold the principles of self-reliance, self-discipline, morality, and above all, responsible liberty for every individual, that we will become that shining city on a hill."
So tell us the significance of that speech in announcing his 1980 presidential campaign.
He uses a very important phrase there, rendezvous with destiny, which he used in all of his important speeches. Speech for Goldwater in 64, this one in 79, his speech accepting the Republican Party nomination in Detroit in 1980. Interestingly enough, he got the phrase from Franklin Roosevelt. Roosevelt unveiled it in 1936, accepting his party's renomination for President of the United States. And Reagan at the time was a radio broadcaster in Des Moines, Iowa, known to his audience as Dutch Reagan on WHO radio. He's listening to Franklin Roosevelt. Roosevelt says to the audience gathered there, he says, "There is a mysterious cycle in human events. To some generations, much is given. Of other generations, much is expected. This generation of Americans has a rendezvous with destiny." Reagan hears that, and he falls in love with the phrase. It's lyrical. It's poetic. And so he used it for all of his own important speeches, even though it came from a Democrat.
All right. Billy is calling in from Crockett, Texas, on our Democratic line. Hi, Billy.
Good morning. Thank you. I want to say all praises to C-SPAN. I'm a frequent caller. I want to ask you, I guess, about the legacy of Ronald Reagan
and the Contra situation. With me being an African American, there's a controversy surrounding Oliver North, the CIA, and Ronald Reagan, and the bill that they passed that put crack cocaine on the streets of America. We never did get a clear understanding of how that situation was handled, and we don't know what role that Ronald Reagan played in it. From the streets, the word on the streets was that he was behind it, and Oliver North then put it, and we know what devastation it has done to black people, crack cocaine on the streets of America. And I'm in the age group where I watched when it first came on the streets, and it devastated America. It devastated black America to this day. And I want to ask the guest, since he's a biographer of Reagan, what responsibility does he think the former president have for that devastation that happened during the crack and the Contra situation?
Okay.
Thank you for taking my question.
There's no evidence whatsoever. What happened in Iran-Contra was that Oliver North and John Poindexter put together, hatched a plan to give arms to the Nicaraguan Contras